everybody's in movies. It doesn't matter who you are. There are stars in every city, in every house and on every street. And if you walk down Hollywood Boulevard, their names are written in
color. Yes, they are. Whoa, it's Jim Laskowski coming in live on Directors Club. This is another exclusive bonus episode of Directors Club. Well, I shouldn't say exclusive because, as I said, I'm putting this in the main feed because I want this to reach a lot of people. I'm excited. And it's a nice bridge between the last episode, because I have the same guest, the same voice on the line with me today. But, you know, I don't go to many film festivals, and I wish I could. I wish I could just fly out to all these festivals. And I'm always excited about the local one in particular. You know, and then the hosts of this particular film festival are, of course, members of the Chicago Film Critics Association, and they've been guests on this podcast in the past. And the event takes place at my favorite movie theater, The Music Box. I'm talking about the Chicago Critics Film Festival, which takes place November 12th through the 14th here in Chicago. So if you live in the area, please come out. Joining me to talk about a few of the titles playing is someone that doesn't live in Chicago, but you know him, you love him, and he's going to be contributing his own bonus content within the next week or so. Glad to have you back, Mr. Bill Ackerman.
Thank you for having me back. I was telling you before we started this recording that I've seen quite a few films since the last time I saw any of these films that we're talking about today. So hopefully I still have some coherent thoughts about them, but I'll do my best.
I'm really interested in hearing about the film festival experience in a place like New York or LA. It's always cool to hear when other podcasters get to go to these things, because obviously, Chicago's a big city, and it represents the arts pretty extensively in a lot of different ways, especially with theater. But, you know, the Chicago International Film Festival is renowned, and I've gone to that a couple of times. But I have been attending the Chicago Critics Film Festival since the beginning. I think I may have missed one when I was living in Michigan, but for the most part, I've been supporting this community and this gathering since opening night. And it's also a nice bridge to the next episode I'm recording towards the end of the month with Kate Blair, because the first movie I saw at the Chicago Critics Film Festival, which was the very first edition of the film festival, was Stories We Tell. And Sarah Polley was there in attendance. I got to talk with her for like a minute or two, which was great. And there have been a lot of great premieres and, you know, guest appearances throughout the run of this festival. I mean, the titles that have played include A Ghost Story, Lucky, The End of the Tour, Columbus, First Reformed, Support the Girls, Eighth Grade, In Fabric, and so many more. And we have had guests like Sarah Polley, Joan Cusack, Bobcat Goldthwait, John Carroll Lynch, Paul Schrader, William Friedkin. The list goes on and on. So this year is sort of a truncated version. Usually it takes place over the span of about a week, but this time, due to COVID, I think we had to trim things down and only go for a weekend. A lot of great people put this thing together, and they spend a lot of time and a lot of effort. So I'm grateful for a lot of my my colleagues who, you know, go out of their way to make this happen. You know, guys like Eric Childress, Brian Tallarico, Robert Daniels, Steve Procopi, Sarah Mars, Peter Subchinsky, and Colin Suter. So without further ado, I want to run down a list of the titles that are playing starting Friday night, November 12th. And the first one is indeed The Lost Daughter, written and directed by Maggie Gyllenhaal, based on a novel, and it stars Olivia Colman as a divorcee on holiday whose chance encounter with another woman and daughter causes her vacation to take a dark turn. And it co-stars Dakota Johnson, Ed Harris, Peter Sarsgaard, and of course, one of my new favorites, actresses on the planet, Jessie Buckley.
Miss Caruso, welcome.
Thank you.
Excuse me. I work at the beach house. Just let me know if you need anything.
Great. Kids. Yes, I have two daughters. Hey, your mommy's a girl.
You're my big girl.
She's driving me crazy.
What were your daughters like when they were little?
I can't remember much, actually.
This is a title, that my guest has seen. And obviously, without giving anything away, Bill, what did you think of The Lost Daughter?
I think it's a great film. And the novel is, for anyone that is a fan of hers, Elena Ferrante, I believe, is the novelist.
Yes.
But I went into this cold, and I don't really like talking about plots too much of films that people haven't seen yet. I would say that, without spoiling anything, it feels to me, I thought of French films that are like meditations on the thriller rather than thrillers themselves. I don't know what I mean is like certain films like by Claude Chabrol, or like even things like with a friend like Harry that came out like, you know, years later, but like films that feel like a lot of like emotionally complicated characters, like, in a series of tense situations that feel kind of fraught with menace, but aren't really building towards a chase scene or a kind of violent showdown. Like, it's not quite building towards like a Hitchcockian thing, but it feels tense in a way that like you might associate with a thriller.
It's character driven. Right.
It's more character study kind of film. And, I was thinking about this with the list of films that you told me that we might be talking about that I had seen. And what they all have in common is that like none of them are about likable characters overcoming obstacles to achieve a goal. Like they're all films that like deal with not traditionally sympathetic kind of main characters. And Lost Daughter, I think, when viewers get a chance to see it, I think Olivia Colman is phenomenal as in the lead part, but it's not an easy character to like. And you get to understand why she is the way that she is. But I'm curious if many people will check this out because of her or Jessie Buckley or Dakota Johnson, and whether or not they will find that to be a barrier or not. I'm very curious to see how it's received. I know critics are going crazy over it. And understandably, because I think that this and the Jane Campion film we'll be talking about are like, both based on novels, and they unfold kind of like novels. Quick moving point A to point B kind of plot structure kind of movies. I think that they kind of reveal their hand gradually, which I like a lot. Like I said, I went into this with no real expectations. I thought, I know Maggie Gyllenhaal as an actress. And so, never could be too sure with like when famous performers become filmmakers, what that's going to look like. But yeah, no, this was, you'd never know it was her first film. I mean, it's as short as anything I saw at the festival, really. I think
that's exciting.
Any degree of hyperbole that you're going to hear about it, I get it. I mean, I don't want to hype people up too much in advance because, it's kind of a subtle movie. It builds kind of slow, but I think it's very good. I think and it's worth seeing in the theater. I know people will be able to check it out on Netflix too, but it will be one that you'll walk out wanting to talk to somebody when it's over, talk about it. That was actually the frustrating thing, seeing it at the festivals. I went by myself and I had to just be like, I can't talk about this with anyone for a couple months now.
Oh, yeah. Well, that's another reason why the film festival is so cool, is because there's a lot of familiar faces come to the theater to support great cinema. And I'm always excited for when an actress that I've long admired or appreciated their work in the past, someone like Maggie Gyllenhaal, I want to see what they do behind the camera. And clearly, I think she's going to be what they call, you know, an actor's director, where you get a good ensemble and they all come together and support her and tell this amazing story. And it sounds like this is a case of great acting on display, but a really compelling narrative to accompany it. So I'm excited.
Yeah. And it's not like an actor letting their actor pals just choose scenery. Like, it's all in service of,
yeah,
of mood and character. Like, it's not handy in any way.
I've heard that a lot of the heavier moments often rest on Jesse Buckley, and
I've not seen her more powerful in anything else than this.
Awesome. She's the main reason why I adore I'm Thinking of Ending Things. I mean, obviously I love Charlie Kaufman, but I also kind of wish, I want him to just keep writing original scripts and not book adaptations, you know, but at the same time, she really brought a lot to that role and, you know, changed personalities in some cases throughout that movie. So I'm excited to see her career evolve, and certainly the debut from Maggie Gyllenhaal. Next up, we have The Power of the Dog, playing right after The Lost Daughter. What a double bill to start the festival on Friday night. And is the long-awaited return of the great Jane Campion. Another favorite. Is this her first feature since Bright Star?
Uh-huh. I believe so, for theatrical films. Yeah.
Yeah, because she did Top of the Lake. I remember that.
Yeah.
And that was a miniseries.
It's just a man. Only another man.
And this stars Benedict Cumberbatch, Jesse Plemons, Kirsten Dunst, Cody Smit McPhee. And it sounds really intense, and it's her sort of remaking the American Western and touching on themes about manhood and intimacy and revenge. And, oh, man, I am on board for just about anything Jane Campion does. And with that cast and a very moody, atmospheric teaser trailer that I saw. I haven't seen the new one. I'm going to avoid that. But I really like the teaser, where it's just, you know, doesn't show you too much. It was like a little bit kind of like the Serious Man trailer, almost just focused on rhythm and the mood and the score and all that. So I was like, bring it to me. I can't wait for this. So this is probably the one I'm the most looking forward to, based on everybody talking about it. You know, everyone who's seen it has said this is going to be an awards contender. So
I think if Paul Thomas Anderson had directed this, like the exact same film, but just like his name on the credits, and this was coming out theatrically, it would be like a sure thing Oscar contender. Like, I have no idea how Netflix will push it, or if Jane Campion like plays the political game, you know, in terms of that kind, but it, you know, like award kind of film. I mean, it feels always weird to talk about films just on that.
Yeah, true. That's true. But we don't want to frame it that way.
What I would say though is that Yeah, and I think this is, again, like, even just as much as The Lost Daughter, it's a great, great film. I mean, one of the best films of the year. I think this one, again, it's going to be on Netflix, but I feel like this is the one that you want to see on the big screen even more because it's composed for like a wider canvas. I feel like there's a fair amount of shots that are, of the characters kind of from a distance. So it might lose something on streaming. I don't know. I've only seen it on the big screen, so I can't say, but that feels like it might impact this one more than The Lost Daughter as far as like seeing it home versus seeing it on the big screen. But, you know, it's like a Western superficially, in that there are horses and cowboys and such. But I feel like the themes of, the masculinity and sexuality, they would apply pretty much the same in a contemporary setting. So I think it's going to resonate with a lot of people. I mean, I don't know if the period trapping is going to scare off people that don't think they're going to be in the mood for a Western, because I don't think that there's any Western cliches about it. Like, it's just, that's just the setting of the novel, and she didn't change that. But, I think, because I mentioned Paul Thomas Anderson, it has a Johnny Greenwood score.
Ooh.
And it has that same kind of, like I think about There Will Be Blood, not in terms of the plot, but just in the way that it's like a technically assured filmmaking on every level. And then it doesn't build towards the kind of like melodramatic climactic conclusion that a mass audience would find satisfying. It might kind of move slightly to the side of what I think would make it a real commercial film. I don't want to spoil anything. I think, any amount of hyperbole that is spoken about it, I think the film probably lives up to it. Just on a first viewing, I've only seen it the one time. But it's one of those films that I was enjoying it in the moment. And then like kind of reflecting back on it from scene to scene, there's so many strong things. It's the best performance I've seen of Benedict Cumberbatch. I haven't seen a lot of things with him, but it's by far the strongest, impact he's had for me. And it's funny, I just think about, because you mentioned, I'm thinking of ending things, and here we have Jesse Plemons in the other big Netflix award film. But I think Power of the Dog is, I mean, it's up there with Jane Campion's best films. I don't know. I think people will like it. I mean, I'm curious to see again, because it's going to be in everyone's home, because of Netflix. I wonder, if audiences, how they will respond to it. I know critics are going nuts over it, but that isn't the same thing as, the public. So I don't know. But yeah, if you're trying to sell people on a night to go to the festival, I mean, The Lost Daughter, Power of the Dog double feature is like, I mean.
I wonder what the Academy Awards are going to lean towards. Again, I don't like thinking in terms of awards and like, oh, that's how you measure a film's merit, and that's how you know it's important and why we should talk about it. But at the same time, like, is it going to be a, because when I see the trailer for the Kenneth Branagh movie, I automatically go, well, there you go, there's going to be the top of the Oscar list this year, because it looks like the ultimate. Yeah. It looks like it could be another Green Book situation where it's an audience pleaser. But then again, they went with Parasite 1 year. So that's what, they're so unpredictable, but I don't know. I just think Jane Campion deserves a lot of recognition she certainly got it with The Piano. So it's not like
that was a little while ago now, though. Yeah,
that's true. That's true. A long time ago, but
What I'd say, though, like, I mean, obviously the Oscars are silly and have a million problems. I would say that they help certain films get seen by a lot of people that wouldn't normally see them. And these are two films that, they are not kind of built franchises around them. They're not like, action films. They will probably not have the same kind of international exposure as films that are like, more spectacular in terms of the, special effects and action and all that. So I think that those kind of awards do help people find out about them. I mean, yeah. You know, so it is a good thing for either one of these films to get recognized in that way. Cause yeah, they could just be good sleepers that only, you know, play festivals and to critics if they don't get like a certain kind of larger push. And Netflix is, I mean, a giant service. So, I mean, people will be able to see them, but things also kind of get lost in the sea of content there too, if there's not hype.
Well, you know, even my aunt, who's not a cinephile at all, you know, she saw Roma just because of all the buzz surrounding it and everybody talking about it. But, you know, it turns out that's not her thing. She watches like, nah, that's not my thing. I'm like, okay, I understand. But, I'm going to fly down some titles too, because some of these we haven't seen, some of which I haven't heard of actually, but you know, they've got the ringing endorsement of all the critics here. Playing Late at Midnight is Zalava, which is a demon horror thriller, possession movie of some kind. It involves an exorcist attempting to rid a village of some kind of demon. So I guess that's an appropriate movie to play at midnight. It takes place in 1978 in a small village in Iran. So that sounds interesting. I hope I can stay up. And then on Saturday afternoon, the fun begins with Colin Suter's always enjoyable and well-curated short film festival showcasing, I believe, 7 titles. And local Chicago actress Claire Cooney will be in attendance for the final selection, which is called Go Ahead, Grab Time by the Throat. Gotta love that title. I always try to go into this part of the festival cold without even reading any synopsis, because it plays the way Colin puts this together, and he does a great job every time. It's like a mixtape in the form of short films. And he puts these together in a specific way, in a specific time. And I try to just like immerse myself into the whole experience, because it lasts about like 100 minutes, and it's again like a little playlist that he puts together, and it's always great. And he's always been passionate about short films and writes about them for RogerEbert.com. And then after that, we have Roy's World, Barry Gifford's Chicago, a documentary which I saw a rough cut a couple of years ago in the smaller theater at the Music Box. But I remember being in a little bit of a daze, and I need to see it again, because, geez, this might have been 2 years ago that I saw that. And I enjoyed it. And I'm a huge fan of Gifford's collaborations with David Lynch, of course, and he's an accomplished author who has led quite the life. And there's some narration from Willem Dafoe, Matt Dillon, Lily Taylor. And just sort of captures 1950s Chicago with like some jazz music, and you know, it's definitely, you know, you're the kind of documentary you expect with some archive footage and talking heads and animation and, you know, spoken word, but it talks about his life in a way that's not unlike the way he writes, and it's a collection of interesting stories that, you know, he talks about what he's been through, particularly with his mom. I know you know the name, obviously, Bill.
Yeah, we'll be on a podcast together, but not recorded together.
right, coming up. That's awesome.
Yeah, I'm dying to see this. I haven't seen it yet, but I mean, that's one of the titles you're listing off that has already been on my radar as one I want to see. So hopefully soon.
Yeah, I don't know if it's got an official release this year or if it's. I'll have to find out about that when I'm there. But next up at 5 p.m., that's when I'm going to be grabbing some dinner, because I've already seen this next pick, and it's quite good, which I described to Bill as kind of like if Darren Aronofsky directed Whiplash. And that's this film called The Novice, which, as I was watching it, made me wish I could get into rowing the way I once did with swimming. Because you really see the physical strength and stamina that it takes to be a professional rower. And Isabel Furman plays a queer college freshman who decides to join her university's rowing team and undertakes a very obsessive physical and psychological transformation to make it to the top of the varsity team. and you know, pushes herself beyond limits in ways that, like I mentioned, remind me of Black Swan. It's directed in that same manner where there's moments where you think she's going mad just because she's really, really doing a number on her body and mind as she's, you know, basically neglecting self-care and sleep in some instances just so she can practice late at night. And I understand her drive and passion to become great at something like that. You know, and it's like, I wish I could. Part of me is like, God, I just need more time in the day and, you know, work less hours at the day job to where I could get up early in the morning and just focus on something like this. Like, I wish there was a swimming pool I could just jump into at 6 a.m. or something, you know. But I definitely recommend everyone check this out. It's very good. It's, man, Isabel Furman, who was an Orphan, if you remember that film. Yeah, very memorable performance in that. She's great. She's great in this. It's a very good film. It's quite intense. It might, and in fact, it may make you want to hit the gym because there's a lot of scenes that take place in situations where, yeah, she's really pushing herself physically. And then right after that is Bernstein's Wall, which I know very little about outside that it's about the composer Leonard Bernstein. So that's that, and I'm sure it's good. Right after that, we have a taut thriller about a former boxer that embarks on the fight of her life when she goes in search of her missing sister. This one is called Catch the Fair One, which I haven't heard of, but it's the second feature for Tribeca Best New Narrative Director winner Joseph Kabuta Walatka. Hopefully... Or I always have trouble with pronunciations. People are used to that. But yeah, that sounds really good. And we're ending this wonderful Saturday night, of course, at midnight with a 40th anniversary presentation of one of my favorite Michael Mann films, and that is Thief with James Caan and a slew of great character actors. Yeah, I wish it weren't playing so late, but I might just have to grab a coffee around dinner time. Since this is playing in 35mm, and it's a great film to celebrate the city of Chicago with, having never seen it on the big screen, I think I owe it to myself to take in Thief at midnight, and I'm sure lots of people...
That would also be a way to see it then without Michael Mann's revisionist color timing that he does on the Criterion release. Oh. So if you... want to see Thief the way people saw it, then you would want to check out that screening.
Good call. Yeah, and then Sunday, we start off the day with a, I believe an anime title. I think, yeah, it's called Bell. It's from Hosada and Studio Shizu, creators of Myra, Wolf Children, Summer Wars, and it's a very fantastical, heartfelt story of growing up in the age of social media. That sounds interesting. Suzu is a shy, everyday high school student living in a rural village. For years, she has only been a shadow of herself, but when she enters a massive virtual world, she escapes into her online persona as Belle, a globally beloved singer. I'm down for this. Sounds cool. After that, we have another anticipated title that I'm hearing great things about called Procession, which is about six men who are all survivors of childhood sexual assault at the hands of Catholic priests and clergy. And it's pretty heavy, obviously, with that subject matter. They create fictional scenes based on memories, dreams, and experiences meant to explore the church rituals, culture, and hierarchies that enabled silence around their abuse. So, oh yeah, we're in for something special with this film, I'm hearing, so I can't wait for that. And then something a little more uplifting with this horse drama. Can't get enough of horse dramas, right? The big selling point is Clifton Collins Jr. is the lead, I believe, and he will be there for the Q&A following his latest film called Jockey, in which he plays an aging jockey that hopes to win one last title for his longtime trainer, played by Molly Parker, who I really, really adore as well. So that's great. That's a great run of films there. And we close out the festivities with a title that Bill has seen from Sean Baker, who, oh, I adore his last two films so much. And that I'm talking about, of course, is Red Rocket, which, again, I know nothing about.
You said you're never going to step a foot in Texas again.
I know, this is unexpected.
Oh, nothing with you is unexpected.
Your last job is over 17 years ago. That's quite a gap.
Well, you know, I've worked almost every day for the last 17 years. I moved back in with my wife last week.
No, I'm calling the cops. Four, nine,
really?
Eight.
We decided to make a run of it.
I just need a place to crash for a couple of days. What's the big deal?
Mikey, go fuck yourself.
All right, look, I'm going to be straight with you. I'm an adult film actor.
Excuse me?
So why are you back, Mr. Hollywood?
You're Mikey. Welcome back, dude.
I'm on top of my game right now on, like, every single possible level. Physical stamina. My mind is sharp. I'm taking 5-HTP for serotonin in my brain.
Yeah.
Dude, with my skill and ability, there's no denying what I can do. The universe is on my side, bro.
Before long, it'll be like we're still married.
We are still married.
I'm excited for this. It stars Simon Rex, of all people. That's a name I haven't heard in a long time. So what'd you think?
I liked it. I mean, Simon Rex was not someone I knew at all. Cause I had seen him in The Forsaken like 20 years ago. And that is the only time I've ever had any exposure to him. I don't even remember that film at all, but I looked into his credits after I saw Red Rocket. And I guess he's known for being an MTV VJ or
yes,
for doing music was Dirt Nasty. He has like 70 acting credits, but I don't know him really. So he's fantastic in this. It's like Tangerine and the Florida Project in that it's another film kind of set in kind of working class environment. But I don't know. I thought of films as disparate as like Henry Fool or Naked or even Miami Blues, as far as like, it's about like this not completely likable kind of character who's like kind of this charismatic fuck up who drifts into town and starts shaking things up. But he's not, he's anti-hero is a kind way of putting it. Like, he's not a sympathetic character in many respects, but he's your protagonist and you kind of have to go on the journey with him. But it's, yeah, it's like a, satirical slice of life comedy, you know. I guess the class setting that it's put in gives it like a, there are like political undercurrents to it, but it's mostly a hangout type, you know, situation comedy. I don't want to spoil any of the jokes or any of the situations. I'd just say that if I had a group of friends over, this would probably be the one that be most likely to play to a crowd of friends at my house of the three films that I'm talking about here today. It went over really well with the audience at the New York Film Festival when I saw it there. I think you'll like it. I think it's, I think Simon Rex, I don't know if this will like lead to him starring in more films, but he's remarkable as the lead character in this. Because you haven't seen it yet, I don't want to say too much more, but I'll be curious to hear your thoughts on it when you do.
I see the poster has him. Gosh, just looks like it's an 80s sex comedy. When you look on Letterboxd and you see the poster for Red Rocket, it's him naked in the middle of a donut. Again, like in Tangerine, I guess there's some donut shop scenes of some kind. So
great. Yeah, there are. I'm glad I didn't go into it knowing even the premise, because it kind of sells it as one kind of thing that I don't know. Like, fast forward if you don't want to know anything, but it's, you know, about like someone that like, I guess was a former porn star, like trying to kind of get his life back on track, you know, but he's the kind of character that is always just out for himself and likes kind of fucks people over at any given turn. He's not like a he's not as extreme a character as Johnny and Naked, but I thought of someone like that, or Henry Fool, but like just somebody that is a big personality that kind of steamrolls people, but is, you know, like very self-serving and like, you know, engages in some behavior that you're not gonna probably be comfortable with. But it's played for laughs and it is funny. So,
great. Yeah. That sounds like a nice note to end on with the festival, you know, and it's funny. You mentioned Naked, and that of course has David Thewlis. I almost feel like we should mention a Toni Collette movie now, since that way we've covered the cast of I'm Thinking of Ending Things. Huh. I don't know if there's a way to tie it all together, but
yeah, like I said to you before, I saw 92 films since the last time I saw any of these three. So I'm going off of like very hazy memories already.
Well, that's to be expected. And it's like, I don't know. I can't do one of these festivals where even something like Sundance, I was considering maybe I could try to see if I can, you know, get the virtual experience with, but man, just binging on that many films at once, I don't know if I'm wired that way. Like I have to take time to process things. Like I can watch obviously three or four movies in a row in one day, and I certainly have, but man, the people who just binge and binge and binge and wind up seeing like, you know, 20, 30 titles in a small group of a small, you know, time frame, it's like, ah, makes me implode a little bit. But
yeah,
I'm excited.
Yeah, I mean, all three of these are very much worth anyone's time that, you know, is a film fan or, you know, cinephile or whatever. I mean, these are all interesting works. So I'm especially keen on the two Netflix films, The Lost Daughter and Power of the Dog, but Red Rocket, I am very curious to see what people make of this too. But they all made a positive impression on me, you know, and I saw them among like over 20 films at that festival.
Great. Well, thanks for talking with me, Bill. The Chicago Critics Film Festival takes place at the Music Box Theater. All screenings are in person and proof of vaccination is required. Yes. And of course, masking mandates will be enforced. Films begin on time. Seating is not assigned. Yay. I love that. Yeah, it's going to be a great weekend, everybody. So I hope you show up. Bill, I wish you were there, but I know you're hard at work right now. I don't know if you want to talk about all the things you're working on, but you can certainly hint at what the next bonus episode will be, because it's all you, and I'm really thrilled. I'm really thrilled for this particular experience you're about to have very soon.
Yeah, well, I guess I'll be talking about Zeros and Ones, the new Abel Ferrara film with Mr. Ferrara, the last director that we talked about at length on Directors Club. So I guess I'll be talking to him by the time this episode that we're having now, I guess, drops. Maybe I'll have already had that conversation. But yeah, I'll be doing an episode on Zeros and Ones, his new film with Ethan Hawke, which I guess opens later this month. And yeah, that should be interesting.
For sure. Thank you for doing that. And thank you for being here today.
Sure.
You'll be back next year for sure. And I'll be happy to promote all the things that you work hard doing, including past episodes of your great show, Supporting Characters, which people can find over at the Now Playing Network, of course.
Yes, yeah, keep an eye out for that show. Will return eventually, and I'll be on an upcoming episode of Projection Booth on David Lynch's Lost Highway, and Genre Grinder, Gabe Powers' show on Now Playing. I'll also be on that very soon, so plenty of podcasting ahead of me.
And we're all looking forward to it. Thanks again.
Thank you.
Thank you so much for listening. Thank you, Bill. Please stay tuned for his amazing new interview, bonus episode, with Abel Ferrara as they talk about his latest film, Zeros and Ones. Very grateful once again to Bill for being here. I'll see you in a couple weeks for the Sarah Pauly episode with Kate Blair. Please visit directorsclubpodcast.com and send me an email, directorsclubpodcast@gmail.com. Thanks again. Take care. And I'll see you soon. Bye-bye.